This is Ham Radio Now. I don't know what episode number this is going to be, but we are at the Dayton Hamvention here in building number 6, what I lovingly call Tent City. Let me move this around a little bit to not cover up my face quite so much. And we're going to talk about amateur television. So I've got here in my booth
Mel K0PFX.
Mel, you are a veteran of Ham Radio Now. You've been on more shows than I have, I think. And you brought a guest.
Yes.
Mike Collis WA6SVT.
Okay, so Mel is all things digital no matter what, but you were telling me you're kind of leaning toward the television part.
Yes, I have. Last couple of years I've been working in digital ATV and really enjoying it. It's been very interesting.
All right, and Mike, you are the editor for this. I think it'll show up on that camera pretty well. ATV Quarterly, is that correct?
Correct. Also, Rod
Fritz. Climb way up or pull that mic closer to you.
Also, Rod Fritz, WB9KMO, is going to be the new publisher of the magazine, and I'm going to continue to do layout for it. So he's basically taking over the business office end of it.
Okay. You've had some articles now and then, too, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Do a little bit of writing. All right. We will talk about ATV in just a moment. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Arvin is here. Hang on. I got to grab an Arvin. sitting up on the table. Folks have been stuffing money in Arvin here at Dayton, so I appreciate all that. If you can't be here, hamradionow.tv is the website to go to. Starving Arvin, and you can help feed the pig. Let's talk ATV. This setup around here would be an ATV operator's dream, I would imagine, or perhaps a nightmare.
Yeah, cameras, the lighting.
Very nice.
Yeah, very nice.
Come on. ATVers do this?
Anybody?
Do this. Climb up on those microphones, guys. See what I'm doing here?
I think in Mike can talk. He's got a fellow in his group that's really puts on a show for ATV.
Yeah, that's Roland Hoffman, KC6JPG. He uses a VMix and has a virtual studio to do the nets.
Okay, so he can switch cameras and put more websites and stuff on.
He also brings in IP video from all over the world, checking into the net, as well as the linked ATV repeater system in the southwestern part of the United States.
All right, so now let's take a giant step back and get the eagle eye view of what amateur television is all about. Whenever anyone gives a talk to the general public about ham radio, they always bring up ATV because it's one of the coolest things there is in amateur radio. You know, maybe talking to the International Space Station might be the coolest thing, and then operating ATV. But does anybody actually do it? Very niche.
They do on the ISS. There's a digital ATV transmitter up there.
Yeah, okay, okay. So that combines cool number one and cool number two. But to me, it seems like a very niche thing. You don't really run into anybody who operates ATV unless you're at a club meeting where they're doing a demo.
Depends what part of the country. There's a lot of ATV activity.
And by a lot, you mean three guys in one big city.
More than that. Yeah.
Four guys.
Yeah.
Well, on our Tuesday night net, we have over 25 check-ins on video, about a half a dozen to a dozen on voice-only check-in with the ATV intercom channel, and we have about 35 checking in on through the internet that are watching our streaming video all over the world.
I don't know if you can hear that in the background. That's a big thunderclap. We heard a little rolling a moment ago, so I got a feeling that we are going to get a thunderstorm going by
and
here.
The rain's coming down.
Yeah. Starting to rain.
Yeah.
And so far, it hasn't really leaked right on top of where the booth is. But I didn't have all the cameras and microphones out to attract it. So we'll see what happens. All right, so I challenge you that ATV is not the world's most popular thing, and you come back and say, I got 25. What town is that has 25 people?
Well, that's the Southern California, Las Vegas, Nevada, which is all tied in by microwave. And in our chapter in Arizona, they have about a dozen check-ins.
Okay, so it takes the second largest city in America and then three more states around it to be tied in to get 25 people on television.
Well, Columbus, they have about a dozen check-ins every week on their net.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm not being critical. I'm trying to be analytical that ATV is not the most popular thing in the world.
It's not as popular as 2 meters or 440 or CW or sideband on the HF bands.
And there's people who complain that the repeaters are dead anyway, so you know nobody's operating FM in repeaters. So what attracted you to get on television? Now, Mel, you've been in digital voice for a long time, but you've had ATV for a while.
Yeah, I was on analog ATV for a number of years. We had a good group in St. Louis. It was a lot of fun transferring pictures back and forth. And then I found out about digital ATV, which will allow you an unlimited amount of content that you can use for that. You know, send your desktop, not just your mug, back and forth. Share programs, because it's you're at high definition. It changed a lot in from the 480i analog that we had. So it spurred a lot of interest. Plus, the fact that the technology changed, allowing us to do that, especially from a company in Taiwan, who had some commercial gear. And I'm not sure how they found out about ham radio. Maybe Mike can talk about that. But they did modifications to their equipment, which allowed us to use it on the ham bands and in high definition. So that's what got my interest, was the low cost ability to transmit and receive it for low cost equipment.
Back in the analog days, and we're not out of the analog days, right?
No, there's still analog TV, both AM and FM.
And there was pretty much one commercial manufacturer making ATV stuff,
back in the late 80s, early 90s, there was about three or four, but the primary one was PC Electronics, and that was by Tom O'Hara, W6ORG, who's now retired, so PC Electronics is no longer in business.
All right, so is anybody making analog stuff?
Jim Andrews at KH6HTV Video, or HTV, he has a company called KH6HTV Video, and he sells both digital and the analog. He uses the high-des modulators and receivers, and then uses his amplifiers with those. So those are a plug-and-play item that you would connect into a high-des system for digital, and he also has the analog modulator. Jim also has a transmitter that has the analog modulator with a jack in the back that you can plug the digital exciter in, so you can do analog or digital without having to buy a whole new transmitter.
Most of this stuff is on what band?
Probably most of it is 70 centimeters and 1.2 gigahertz band, or 23 centimeter band.
All right. One of those easier to operate than the other?
No, not really.
Uh-uh. No. Possibly 1.2 is easier because it's got smaller antennas, of course.
or bigger for more gain.
Yeah. And the equipment that Mike was talking about, I've got some of it here. You can see the very small size of this modulator transmitter.
Okay, there you
right
can
here.
See
it. Mm-hmm. HDMI connector on the back, so you have connectivity to any HDMI device. Also has an analog output. Here's the antenna here and 12 volts here.
I think we're going to hear a thunderclap.
Yeah.
Pretty sure you guys heard that one.
Yeah. And here's a typical receiver. Same size box as a transmitter. Antennas on the back. This is actually a dual diversity one. HDMI again, input 12 volts. So very small, compact equipment.
Yep.
These two pieces will give you ATV on 1920 by 1080 high def TV.
And did you see the price? I was dialing up my radar.
Here's their ad right here for high def.
Yeah.
Okay. Can they say what it costs?
They have several different models for about $500 for both transmitter and receiver.
Yeah, the receivers, depending which model you have, the basic one is 169. The quad band one, which works all the way to 2.4 gigahertz, is 269. And low-end modulators at about $349, and their high-end is about $560.
So the package you're going to put together of the stuff is still under $1,000.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. So,
and then you add a camera, which everybody's got.
Correct.
They also make a dongle. This sells for, I think, $220. It's full tuplex, and it's transmit and receive. All it needs is an amplifier, and use this with your PC. Well, these are standalone. They don't require any PC other than to configure them.
So equipment-wise, things are getting better and better.
Yes.
Correct.
You won't find them advertised much in QST or in general.
But you do find them in amateur television
quarterly.
ATV
quarterly.
Yes.
So I guess what I'm saying is that these are not obvious items for anyone to find. You have to kind of go look at it.
Yeah, they're sold on eBay as well, this whole line of equipment.
And if you want some really detail about them, Mel and some of the other guys have done tapper forums from DCCs talking in depth about the equipment, all on Ham Radio Now, so you can go find them.
Right.
So somebody gets interested in ATV, and the audience that we're going to talk to at the beginning of the show, we're going to consider that to be the generalist ham audience, people who might not ever get into ATV, but curious about what it's all about. So we'll give them enough information to get them aware. And then, we'll have a small tier of folks that it's really coming down out there. It's dry here so far. A small tier of folks that do get the bug and want to go figure out what this stuff is all about. And then it's your guys, the folks that read the magazine and already operate, they're going to be watching just to make sure that you guys don't screw up too bad and that I don't treat you too badly. This, by the way, I looked at the radar. This is a very tiny thunderstorm. It's going to move by really quickly.
Wow. Get a free car wash when you park for the convention.
Yeah. Well, it wouldn't be Dayton without a few of these big thunderstorms. I can't imagine the folks at the far end of the flea market huddling under what few tents there are available, because they got a long walk to get to the
drive. They're probably climbing the fence to get into the grandstands. That's covered.
Yeah. All right, so for the generalist and maybe for the guys that say, yeah, I'm kind of interested, tell me a bit more about it. What do most people do with ATV? Do they have shows like this? Do they get guests? And do they have a band? I guess you can't do a band.
No.
Well, sometimes they'll do a show like this. A good example of what we do is help promote other clubs. There's the first Thursday of every month, the San Bernardino Microwave Society. They're heavy into the 10 gigahertz CW sideband. And they have a meeting that has both, they pass the microphone around and people bring projects that they're working on, and they show that over the ATV.
So they're broadcasting a club meeting.
Right. And then they have a usually very high-end guest speakers that talk about microwave or UHF projects. And they have a very well-prepared presentation. And so that's also put on the ATV, not just for the general audience, but they have members now with that organization that are all over the world that tune into that
program. We're getting a little river here. I'm going to...
There's your backpack sitting in the box.
Oh, I'm in the middle of an interview.
And your electronics.
Your wall warts are getting flooded.
Yeah, let's bring them up a little bit.
There's literally an inch of water under our feet right now.
Yep, we're starting to get a little bit of a flood. All right, so you can broadcast a club meeting. Now, that is, I know what it takes to put together just some equipment and do a show. That's a non-trivial thing to do.
It's a three-camera shoot, two sets of wireless microphones, plus a couple of fixed microphones.
All right, so somebody's putting some effort into it.
Yes, that's Gary Heston, W6KVC, started that, and then Roland Hoffman, KC6JPG, is also involved in it.
I'm going to get a little more AC off the floor.
Okay.
Marty has arrived. He is going to police our power. I think I got the audio back going.
Yep.
I think I got all of the AC and anything that might electrocute us up out of the water, unless it gets to be a deeper flood. You can stick that in the box there. Okay, so there are guys that go non-trivial that will put a lot of effort in. Do they record those and put them on the internet, or is it just
quite
ATV?
A few of the sessions are recorded and put on YouTube.
Okay, but for most people, it's just going to be sitting in the shack talking to somebody.
Well, yeah. Besides that, somebody may be working on a piece of equipment and they're showing how they do it, and other people may ask questions. So how do you get this circuit tuned up or different techniques like that? Yeah. So that
I'm never going to get you guys to actually lean up on the mics, am I?
Okay, is this better?
Now you can work some DX, yeah.
Okay,
so you can show people what you're doing.
Correct.
Can be creative, but my experience with hams is that few are particularly creative.
Well, that's where there's a few of those on ATV, but there's a lot of creative talent with ATV.
Yeah, and now I'm going to get myself in trouble with that comment because it's a little too general. They are creative in terms of technology, in terms of doing things, but they very few put themselves out to the media the way we're doing this here, the way us podcaster groups does. It's a it's kind of an introverted society. And just listen to folks who talk on the air. It's hard to generate a really interesting conversation. It kind of gets boring out there.
Yeah. Maybe I haven't experienced that too much with ATV. I think just the fact that you can get people on the air and they're comfortable with a camera in front of them. I think there's some different people that do that versus the ones you're talking about.
So you can pull some folks out of the woodwork and get them.
I think that's what we found.
Starting to get a little moist over here. I promised this thunderstorm was going to go by really quickly. So I think it's starting to die down.
Yeah. And I think our group's probably a little bit more typical of what you're talking about. This ham shack, the ham shack. We haven't really done anything out in the public with it yet. I mean, we thought about doing it. We did back in the analog days, but we haven't done with digital yet.
Yeah.
But we do show our projects. Like I was working on a digital repeater that we recently got on the air, and I was able to show the stages that I went through of building it. So that garnered some interest in the repeater itself. So that was helpful.
Okay.
And being in high definition, you know, we're able to dig right down and see it. So that's great.
So let's talk about that change from analog to high def. Hams put up with some pretty marginal signals on ATV in analog, I think, from what little encounter I've had in the talks that you guys have given. If you could see a picture at all, and it, especially if it made some color but was full of noise,
That was back in the simplex days.
That was 5.9.
Yeah, simplex where you're looking, trying to work some DX.
Okay, so repeaters are a thing
for more
now.
Of a reach. Yeah, yeah. But so, that's still being done, of course. Yeah.
But with repeaters, especially with linked repeaters, everybody is trying to get a quality picture into the repeater so they can actually enjoy using the medium rather than just, I've got the DX signal.
But the change to digital has made that far better.
You don't need nearly as much power to get a snow-free picture. That's
yeah. But digital is no such thing as a snowy picture. It's one of those, it's there or it's not.
There's the digital cliff with about a 1.5 or 2 dB range between go and no-go.
Yeah. And I watch broadcast television at home with indoor antennas, and I have to move them around from one station to another. So I know what it looks like when the picture disappears. You get little blocks and, you know, things break up a little bit or it'll freeze and then come back. Imagine that happens at the fringe, because hams like to operate at the fringe for some reason.
Yeah, it does happen. But with a good coverage in your repeater, you can virtually eliminate that. Not entirely, but at any time in a metro area where I am, you know, we were able to receive the repeater with fairly marginal antennas, but something, you know, up off the ground. Yagi's work the best, of course, but it's vertically polarized, so if you're close enough, you just need a vertical antenna. And 440, and that's not much of an antenna. So.
Now, broadcast television stations, they're running hundreds of kilowatts, and your repeater, essentially the same frequency, or very close to the same frequencies, probably not 1,000 or 2,000 feet high, although maybe you get a few repeaters up there.
Yeah.
We have one over 10,000 feet.
Okay, you got a mountain. and a few tens of watts, then it's not a broadcast signal, so trying to receive it on something that you receive broadcast is not going to really work.
Well, I mean, I work in the broadcast industry for one of the major networks in Los Angeles, and
So your repeater does run 10 kilowatts.
Well, we're running, we do have a repeater up at the transmitter site running 100 watts into a 10 dB antenna, so we're about 1 kW effective radiated power, minus a couple of dB for feed line loss. But we had a situation at our broadcast station where we lost 1/4 of the array, transmitter shut down. I was able to fake the transmitter into operating at low power. And at one point, we had a tower crew working, and I brought the transmitter down to 200 watts on RF channel 43.
Oh, your broadcast station.
On the broadcast station. I called a friend of mine 60 miles to the east, another one about 50 miles to the west, and one about 30 miles to the south. All had outside antennas. They were still getting a perfectly good picture, and we had very little calls. So the digital broadcast signal, other than the people with rabbit ears, had problems. Yeah. But anybody with an outside antenna, no problem.
So power is not all it's not all it's cracked
up. And that's why the amateur television works so well, because most of us are using an outside antenna. We're not needing the 500,000 watts effective radiated power on UHF or a couple 100,000 watts on VHF, because we're not trying to penetrate buildings to work a rabbit ear, a TV of rabbit ears 40 miles away to try to get a good signal.
Yeah, so hams are building real stations, as
right.
You'd expect them.
You don't necessarily need super high-gain antennas, but just to get something that's resonant, that has 6 to 15 dB of gain, 10, 15 feet off the roof will do wonders compared to an indoor antenna.
Yeah. Now, if your idea of ham radio is, you know, one of these with an antenna like this, it's not going to do it. Although, is there any HTATV going on yet?
I've got one.
Of course you do.
But some of the folks may remember the old ICOM R3s. The sensitivity is not as good as a quality receiver. However, in our areas, going into our repeaters are output mostly on the 1.2 gigahertz band. You can be 30 miles away and still pick up the repeater with the, and it's still analog, except for one that has a digital output. But you can pick it up on the R3. But we have the altitude, so that helps.
Yeah. Yeah. Mount Wilson?
Wilson, Santiago Peak, Snow Peak. We've got several the high mountaintops all the way around Southern California, Arizona, and southwestern Nevada.
Yeah. I've been up on top of Mount Wilson a long time ago, but it was amazing. let's talk a little bit more about this change to digital. The equipment is affordable. You have to be a little dedicated, but it's available and affordable and has improved things and made things a lot easier. Is it bringing more people into ATV?
The digital has made quite a change. There's another type of video that's ran through the mesh systems they call video over mesh, and that's bringing more of the IP type hams that are more into data systems that want to play around with video. So there's starting to be a merge between regular ATV and you running video over mesh systems.
Okay, now Mel's going to see if I've been paying attention to his talks and the other guy's talks. There's more than one way to do digital ATV. It's a lot to choose from.
That's right, yeah.
So without being super technical about it, what have we got to choose from? What's the advantage of one versus another? Yeah, the only thing anyone's familiar with is what's being broadcast over, here in America anyway, over broadcast,
right,
what they call ATSC.
Yeah, or they also know it as eight-level vestigial sideband.
Yeah. So that's what we all see when we're watching.
Mm-hmm.
Well, actually, that's not what we all see. It's what we all see if we're watching over the air, but if we're watching cable, we're watching something different.
It's similar, but it's QAM 64 or 256. It's like QPSK format, but it's the constellation is larger.
So very different ways of putting together a digital signal.
Right, and we ran experiments with the single, what they call single carrier QAM64, so it was compatible with American TV sets in the cable TV mode. However, we needed a lot more signal than we do using DVB-T format, which is a European format.
Okay, so which formats have become popular, and is there still a variety, or is it?
The QPSK probably is the most commonly used, with QAM, quadrature amplitude modulation 16 being the second one. With QAM 16, we can run at a narrower bandwidth, like 4 megahertz, and still run 1080p by 1920.
I have absolutely failed on keeping you up close to that microphone, haven't I?
Basically,
it's never going to work.
What Mel's mentioning is in the both the DVB-S format, which is a satellite digital format, which is popular in some areas because of the free-to-air satellite receivers that have an input on 1.2 gigahertz. They just put a preamp in the antenna and they can receive. The DVB-T is more popular in the 70-centimeter band. Because the equipment Mel just said, they're ready to go, plug and play.
There's nothing about your TV that can receive that. You do need the receiver.
We just use the HDMI output typically to the TV, or some of the equipment has composite video, the old analog video output. But what Mel was mentioning between QPSK and 16 is where the 8 VSB system is fixed at a little over 19 megabit data rate, you can't make it more robust by using a slower or less complicated constellation pattern, such as QPSK, which is a four level, too high, too wide. So you have sort of like tic-tac-toe. Looks,
if I understand.
Okay. But you're able to say, okay, I want to modulate it at the QPSK rate. And they can do the same thing with DVB-S. You can vary that data rate. So the faster the data rate, the more signal you need, but you can run more HD with that. So
Is there a bandwidth consideration as well, how wide a channel you're using?
Well, most of the ATV channels are 6 megahertz. In some areas where we ran analog, for example, on 434 megahertz, since most of the energy was near the video carrier, we didn't bother the weak signal at 432 or the Oscar subband up 435 to 438. When we, however, running DVB-T, we do not purposely run 6 megahertz because we don't want to overlap in the 432 megahertz weak signal or into the Oscar subband. So we fit it between 433 and 435, and there's no interference to the other services because you have full power all the way across the bandpass.
So by adjusting the data rate, you're effectively adjusting the bandwidth?
There's a setting. Almost like changing channels on the old TV sets.
Okay.
Except in the computer, say, okay, you want 2 megahertz bandwidth, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8.
And how badly does that affect the picture?
For standard definition, 2 megahertz with anything as slow as QPSK works just fine. If we want to run, we've ran HD in 2 megahertz using QAM 64 modulation and at 1080i. And with 720p, we're able to do it with QAM 16 modulation of the carriers. We have tried it with QPSK, but if you start moving the camera around, it starts freezing up the picture a little bit.
So you want to talk slowly and not move too much.
Oh, I mean, you can do talking head video just fine in HD at 2 megahertz, but you start, most people, they start moving around like this, and you're going to want to bring the data rate up. The other option is to bring the RF bandwidth up, which is that selection I mentioned.
But you can't keep increasing the data rate without increasing the bandwidth.
Up to where the RF bandwidth is selectable, almost like changing the channel or the bands on an HF rig. You want this 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way up to 8 megahertz. Now, if you're but having said that, you can also change the modulation, QPSK 16, 64. So it's a combination of what bandwidth you selected and what modulation to the DVB-T. And DVB-T uses multiple carriers. It's like virtual subcarriers. And that's used for multipath to reduce for the reflections off buildings and mountains and stuff so that the signal still gets through. So depending on what you're wanting to run, and Mel can, because he's done more of the HD than we have. I believe you're using, 6 megahertz?
Yeah, we're using 6. But we can run it at 4. But we also found at 6 megahertz, which meets the standard, the European standard DVB-T, that there are low-cost dongles available, like the RTL SDR dongle, and with free software, VLC, which is a media player that has a capture mode. You can just plug in the it's very similar to this one. It's only $20 with free software. Plug it in, and you're able to decode ATV and high def.
Okay.
So it's a very low-cost entry way to get into
antenna,
it.
Unless you're sitting right on the repeater.
Yeah, right, right.
So we got a variety. Is it really bringing more people in?
Absolutely.
Yes, sir. Yes, it has.
How do you get those people? I mean, here's one way. You talk on a ham TV show. Presentations at club meetings and ham fests and stuff?
Yeah, that's probably the best way to do it. Yes.
So when you do an ATV forum at a ham fest, do you get more than 12 people in the audience?
It all depends.
It depends on the ham fest, you know.
About Dayton, you know, you might get 30.
Yeah, it takes a while to get the word out. So I think building a repeater obviously helps a lot, too. Now, once they can see how it works, especially at at a very low cost where they're only having to use a dongle that has other purposes, you know, besides ATV, for $20, a lot of people will try it.
And there are places, you said, places you can go on the web to watch what people are doing over the air, and it gets captured someplace and then spit out on the web?
Mm-hmm. There's a large amateur TV club in Great Britain called British Amateur TV Club. And they have a large video server, and they allow all the ATV repeaters anywhere in the world to stream their video. So it's a central location. You can come in and then scroll down to what repeater you want to watch, and you can watch it at home on your computer. So if you're out in the middle of nowhere and you want to see, well, what are these nuts on ATV, you can kind of get – it's not high resolution. In fact, it's only about 250, 300-line resolution. And there's a chat room, so you can chat with them. But you get to see what's going on, kind of – test the water, so to speak.
So somebody's got to send them the video from each repeater.
Correct.
Yes.
And is that somebody picking it up off the air and just...
Typically.
And so they can't provide enough bandwidth for everybody to give the best signal or even a very good signal, it sounds like. So a repeater...
Was it about 100, 150 people can tie in at a time?
Yeah,
but no one's seeing... You can get a much better signal by receiving something directly from the repeater. You can get full HD.
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, if they had less video streams, they could provide a bigger stream, but somebody's got to pay for that digital pipe up for that server.
Yeah. Okay. So if you go looking on the BATV site, that's not what you're going to see if you set up your own ATV station.
It'd be much more resolution.
Yeah,
much higher.
And so talking about the repeaters, to get decent signals on 70 centimeters or 1200, you do need a Yagi antenna, I think, which is going to make the signal directional.
Yes.
So back when you were simplex, you would point it at the guy you're talking to, and no one else could see you. I was going to say hear you. See you.
Yeah.
Unless they were in line with that signal.
Right.
So the repeater lets everybody see...
Exactly.
I'm having a real hard time changing the word "hear" to "see."
Yeah. Well, you hear and see. Impact audio. Remember, the video and audio is comparable. You know, full stereo, very good audio.
Yeah, so, sound just as good as we do here on Ham Radio Now.
Yes. Yeah.
What does it take to put a repeater together? I remember the local guys trying to get an analog repeater.
Without a controller, just to get a repeater on the air, it's quite simple. It's a matter of taking a transmitter and receiver and connecting the two with the cable. Output of the receiver going into the transmitter.
A key line in there?
Yeah. A key line you do have to add, but there's a modification to do that. And
I guess you need to add something to ID, technically.
Keys the amplifier. You can just leave the transmitter running all the time. Yeah, because it's only running a milliwatt.
Well, in the case of the digital equipment, you can embed your call sign in there, just like the TV stations have it embedded. So you have legal ID that way.
Okay, I don't have to worry about that.
And by pushing a button on the control of your receiver, like the green button right here, it'll show up. It'll turn on the ID, so you don't have to leave it on the screen all the time.
Like for example, for public service use, these work great to put in a backpack, small amplifier. A little modification of a little push the look button on the back, or connection on the back, that keys a relay for the power amp. The power amp you'd have to add to the transmitter. Put one on one channel, one on another, and then go up on a hilltop. Jim does this a lot with the Boulder, Colorado Racy's group, and they'll go up when they have a forest fire up near the Boulder area. Send one guy down with a helicopter on a ridge, a backpack. Set up a portable relay, and then they can have somebody down to the fire camp to show the video of who's being hurt and different things like that or what supplies they need, and then send it back down to the EOC. So it's
was he doing that back in the analog days?
Yes, he was.
And the digital days improved things a lot.
It's a lot smaller equipment.
Liked it a lot
easier,
better,
better pictures.
Yeah.
As you know, when you build an analog repeater, not only do you have to connect the receiver to the transmitter, because we could all do pretty much mm-hmm. that same thing mm-hmm. with two radios, but the transmitter blasts the receiver away.
You have the same issue. Yeah. You use filters so that the RF end of it is really not much different than analog. It's how you modulate it.
Yeah, but you also need to consider the bandwidth, because our FM signals are 15, 25 kilohertz wide mm-hmm. at most. So the filters can be very narrow and provide a lot of isolation. Yeah. You guys got to deal with 6 megahertz wide channel.
Depends on what part of the country you're in and what's available.
Yeah.
But again, we can go down to 2 megahertz and go all the way up to 6.
Yeah, but you don't want to go down to 2 megahertz just to accommodate being on a repeater. So what do you actually do? Where do you get filters that are going to do that job for you?
Well, they're commercially available, and also Ham out in Colorado has built what they call interdigital filters for repeaters, and that's what we're using.
He manufactured, that's the same one that makes the amplifiers I mentioned, K6HDV video. They're 6 megahertz wide for 70 centimeter band. And there's a company up in Canada called DCI. Most of you hams will be familiar with the one that covers the entire 2 meter band, or the one that covers 440 to 450 to keep out of band signals out. HRO and other ham places have that are pretty inexpensive. But they make a larger filter for multiple bandwidths, FM video, 20 megs wide, 15. They make 6 megahertz wide filters, so it's custom depending on how many poles of filtering and what bandwidth you want. So the cost of those are anywhere from the ones that cover the entire amateur band are about $150 to up to about a grand, almost about $800 to a grand for the fanciest of filters.
Yeah. So if you get the gold-plated filter, it's more expensive than the whole rest of the ATV system.
They do have a line of 6 megahertz wide filters that are designed for the ATV channels that are $200 or $300 cheaper than the custom ones.
So 70 centimeter band seems like a big band from the FM operator's perspective. Most of the repeaters are up in the top 10 megahertz. That leaves 20 megahertz. Seems like a lot of space. There's a little slice for sideband. There's a little bit bigger slice for satellites. Almost everything else is ATV, and suddenly, that's a straitjacket. Yeah. That's not a huge band anymore.
Well, not only that, but in a lot of areas of the country, the 420, the 430 megahertz part of the band is full of point-to-point links to tie 2 meter, 220, and other 440 repeaters
together.
Okay,
so there's even less. You're making my point.
Yeah.
In some areas, you're lucky to get one ATV channel. Some places, you can have two. All depends on how the band's structured.
Yeah, but if you're going to do an in-band repeater, all in 70 centimeters, then you're going to tie up two channels.
Correct.
And, which is all there is. So those filters do a good enough job between the spectrum that you've got?
Oh, absolutely.
What two channels would you use with those?
Well, you could use 426 and 439 or 423 and 441. Again, it depends on who's using the frequencies. You know, what's available, what you can get coordinated.
441 is right in the middle of the voice band, so can you do an ATV repeater there?
You can, yeah. Wow. It depends.
Doesn't it cover up every repeater?
Well, in those areas... go ahead, Mel.
What? I mean, we're doing it in St. Louis when so far we are not covering up anybody.
I just don't know you're there yet.
Yeah.
They
don't know where we're there yet.
Well, in St. Louis, in some areas where there's not a large amount of 440 repeaters, normally the frequency coordinator would start at the high end of the band with the 5 meg offset for repeater input, or some people are flipped the other way, depending on if it's high end or low end frequency, and then they'll start moving down. In other areas that are more populated, like California, they filled up 440 to 450 back in the late 60s, so that was not available to us. Because back in the 1950s, we used to be on 439.25 analog, then we moved to 435, then when they built Oscar 6, we moved to 434, so where most of our power was at the video carrier, it stayed out of the satellites. We ran tests with AMSAT back in those days, where they flew Oscar 6 at 19,000 feet over Southern California, because there was a movement to get ATV completely off the 70 centimeter band back then, and we were able to prove we could coexist. So,
the digital signal for a lot of modes makes a big square block
that is correct
in the spectrum that's big square block in the spectrum that's available. Is that what digital ATV does too?
It's a rectangular signal.
Pretty much a full up to the top all the time.
Correct.
So it's no longer that little bits of signal coming and going.
Exactly why.
So that's why I'm wondering how that can go across an FM repeater band and coexist.
Well, like in our situation, as I mentioned earlier about the Oscar subband and the weak signal band, is why we're running 2 megahertz so that we can still do the same, you know, have the same or less interference than we did on analog ATV and coexist.
Okay, so it's not a one-size-fits-all. You have to pay attention to what's around you.
Right, in other words, the 70-centimeter ARRL recommended band plan, other than the weak signal and the Oscar window, that's about the only thing that's really common. Everywhere else, everything's varied depending on what was set up locally.
Yeah, and in Europe, they don't even have the top 10 megahertz that we have here in Region 2.
They just have 10 megahertz.
We can change the bandwidth of the repeater in just a few seconds, just a matter of configuring it. And we can do it remotely over the net. So if we are interfering, we can go from 6 to 2 in just a couple of keystrokes. So.
All right, so there's ways to do it. And now FM operators who are finding themselves being blasted away by this strange noise know who to call.
Well, they won't even hear it. It's white noise. It just sounds like the squelch is, like the squelch tightened up.
Same thing with people tuning in D-Star, DMR, Fusion on an FM receiver. It's just
Well, our data rates are so much faster. Yeah. The radios typically don't even respond to the signal.
Right.
See it on the S meter. It would degrade someone you're trying to receive, but it wouldn't make noise in the speaker.
That is correct.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Right. So if you can't hear the repeater anymore, call Mel.
Thank you, Gary.
Well, in our area,
doesn't matter why you can't hear the repeater anymore. Just call Mel.
In our area, we have a good rapport with the frequency coordinators, and we did engineering. We had 2 representatives from each mode group when we did the band plans, so that we wouldn't have the problem down the road. So we did this early to avoid problems.
All right. What frequencies are your repeater in LA operating on?
Which repeater?
Okay. Can't have that many.
In general, all of our repeaters in the ATN system in the Southwest have 2441.5 FM input at all sites, analog 434 video, and digital DVB-T on 434. Center, which is the center channel.
And the output is?
Different 1200 frequencies. And that.
Okay, so you don't try to do in-band?
No.
And you find it easier to make the repeater output on 1200 because that's one more difficult stage to handle in just one place?
No more difficult than doing an in-band. In fact, it's actually less. There's less. The filtering doesn't have to be quite as stringent. And a nice advantage is a station accessing the repeater can see his own signal coming back to make adjustments. And we have, in broadcast, you would call it an IFB radio. We call it an ATV intercom. So the station you're talking to can talk back on 2 meters. We have a receiver at each of the repeater sites. So he can have, he's showing his projects working on the other stations. Can talk back, so it's full duplex audio. It's
so you're just adding that 2 meter signal into the television.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
On digital, it's not an audio subcarrier anymore. It's just part of a digital signal.
Right. In our situation, we're primarily on FM. They're subcarriers. All of our repeaters have separate their oral transmitters are not subcarriers.
So even the digital repeaters have an oral
transmitter? No, it's all in the data stream.
Yeah, okay. So how many towns around America, to start with the U.S., have ATV repeaters actually up and running?
There's about a total of 15 digital ATV repeaters, but most of them are out in California, obviously.
Okay, so there's 14 in California and one in what is it, Toledo or Cincinnati?
Well, that's counting Arizona and Nevada, but that's just the digital ones that have digital, either transmit digital, receive digital, or both. In Mel's case, he's, I think, one of the first repeaters to have full HD input and output, which is to be commended for because it's kind of neat. There's some areas of the country that like to do multicasting, just like in broadcast. So they'll look at multiple inputs to a repeater, and then everybody has these multiple screens on. So it all depends on what you want to do. And some people are just running a standard But you have that flexibility, and you don't have to buy new equipment. It's just a couple keystrokes on the computer or a button on the front of the receiver or transmitter, and you can configure for however you want to do your ATV.
And also affords you to have more content than just repeating an input signal. I have a remote HDMI switch, so I can switch in a tower cam, Ubuntu computer, and a media player, and that's all under control of the user on another frequency, on a 2-meter frequency, using touchtones through the controller that I made for it. So it gives you, if somebody's not on the air, then you can go to some other content, go to the computer or go to the media player and see what's been downloaded new and play that back.
I can hear now somebody out there in the background saying, is that legal?
Yeah, certainly. It certainly is legal. Yeah, I mean,
we're not,
I wouldn't call it broadcasting. It's all content that's made up by hams.
So the content that's available is ham-oriented content.
Right. No commercial there at all. No.
Yeah. But you could play this show as long as it don't stick in any music.
Plus, our ID, for example, it's done a lot of work in making up IDs for it, so.
Yeah. Exactly. For example, somebody who missed the interview and heard about this and wants to hear about it, we can download it, put it on like After the Net. We had this great interview with Gary, and in fact, we'll probably be doing that.
Right.
Yeah. So now I can hear somebody say, "Yeah, but I can just watch it on YouTube." They're missing the point, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah. This is what happens when engineers run the show, and not managers. You get all this variety and flexibility and trying things. Do you feel the responsibility to maintain something as a utility, or do you feel you can tinker and break things?
I feel I can tinker. I figure this was a big experiment for me. I hadn't done it before, and so I learned a lot.
FM repeaters went from being tinkerers' paradises to public utilities, practically. Mm-hmm. The repeater goes down, you get the phone starts to ring. What happened to the repeater?
Yeah.
Call Mel.
Yeah.
Well, that was I used to love to build equipment for ham radio, and so much of ham radio started changing to plug and play. And, I mean, any TV kind of got that way too, but there's still a large amount of people who like to build part or their entire station. And that's why I got involved in it.
But to get the maximum number of people participating, to get a lot more people in, you sort of have to start with off the shelf, right?
Right. Well, you have both. Yeah. You can build stuff or you can buy stuff. And for those of us who like
start
to do buildings, you can put an ATV station together for, in some cases, for nothing, depending on what you got in your junk box or what you can pick up at the flea market here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is the transition to digital going to be complete at some point, or do you think the analog guys are going to hang on?
I think they'll hang on for quite a while.
Why?
Because they've got the equipment.
Okay.
We did have one analog guy in our groups, and he was, kind of saddened that we were going all digital because he's got these racks of analog equipment, so
pardon
I can see his point.
I've got the little violin here to play. Well, I mean, we've got such a huge installed base of analog FM repeaters and analog FM users. Mm-hmm. But you guys are almost starting from scratch again anyway because your user base is just pretty small. Are you going to let the analog whiners? I mean,
No. He's endorsed it. He's got equipment on digital, so.
Okay.
Well, in our case, like, for example, 434. It doesn't matter if you run analog or digital. When you're ready to come on the digital, put on digital. I mean, only one station's transmitting at a time.
Okay, so your system fusion.
Yeah, that'd be a good way to put it. Also, so many people think of analog TV as the old AM television, whether it's vestigial sideband filtered or double sideband AM. But most of our users for a long time went over to 2441.5 FM. And the resolution is considerably higher. In fact, our video bandwidth is 5.5 megahertz on our system. And it will handle up to 700 line analog high definition TV. And some of our repeaters have a second output on one of the microwave bands on FM. And you can look at somebody using an old ENG or quality digital camera that produces high resolution analog, and we get pictures that look darn near as good as the digital.
Okay, so I was asking about where, how this is distributed around the states. Clearly, you guys, you live in amateur television nirvana, paradise. And you are trying to create one in St. Louis. Where else? Is there a big ATV in New York City, Chicago, Minneapolis, Detroit, Denver?
I'm not aware of any that's running a digital ATV. There probably
is.
One
I know there's one in Boulder, which point is Jim's repeater.
Yeah.
Art Towsley has one up on the top of the state building in Columbus that was 630 feet.
Yeah, that's just on the road coverage. From here.
Dayton Amateur Radio Club has a ATV repeater.
Okay.
Digital and analog.
And we're picking it up in the booth with the antenna about 12 feet off the ground, and it's the station's like 18, 19 miles away, and it's a perfect picture.
Are they digital?
Yeah, and they're only running 20 watts. All and we're having no problem picking them up.
How tall is their tower?
100 feet. I mean, it's a little more than 100, but the ATV antenna is like at 90 or 100 feet, so it's just maybe 20, 30 feet above the tree line.
And we're how far away?
About 18, 19 miles.
All right. So this is doable.
Mm-hmm.
Do you evangelize? Are you like beating the bushes to get people to do? I mean, it doesn't really affect you because you got your systems, but you'd like to see
more people
do it, I'm sure.
More the better. Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting to see how people set up their station and innovation. What else are you doing with it? What are you doing with the computer with it? I want to see what's on your screen. You can see what's on mine.
Well, just to give you an idea of how the digital is brought new people in, there was I can't remember the call sign at the moment, but one was Fred and one was Skip up in Connecticut. And they decided they'd never been on ATV before, so they did all the engineering research. You know, they just spent the time doing it, put the station together. They had a mount, in our case in California, we wouldn't call that a mountain, but to them it was a mountain. And a DVB-T signal.
He's a geography bigot.
Right. Yeah. So, but they had a ridge line in the way, and they wanted to make sure they had a good picture. Perfect HD signal. And the last, not the spring issue, but the winter issue of ATVQ had their article in there. And they call it Two Novices on DATV.
Mm-hmm.
And if two people who've never been on ATV, no ATV Elmers in the area, can figure out what they needed, bought a couple pieces of equipment, hooked it up the first time to turn a switch on, perfect picture. Anybody can do it.
Yeah, so, okay, not that hard.
No.
The other thing that's occurring to me is, speaking of networking, you got the hams that say, if it's on the internet, it's not real ham radio. Well, your system you're saying is microwave. Is it ham microwave, or are you piggybacking on some state?
No, we built our own.
Wow.
The far end of the system's up on Mount Potosi near Las Vegas. And then I...
Now, is that high Potosi or low Potosi?
High Potosi.
Okay, you got the big mountain.
Right.
So I've got... This is ancient FM stuff, back when they were putting repeaters on mountains outside of Vegas. And there's a mountain called Low Potosi, which I guess had a road that was easy to get up to.
Yeah, we started there, and then the same radio club in Las Vegas owns both sites, and then we moved up to the high site.
Okay, how high is that?
The high site's, I believe, about 8,020 feet or something like that.
Okay, making you jealous, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. 800 feet's high for us.
Yeah. But where I was going with this was, even if it is the internet that is linking stuff, when D-Star first came up, and you'll recognize this phenomenon, put up a repeater, and there were three local guys, and for 4 days they had a ball talking to each other for a couple hours a day, and then they got tired of it. And then you put the internet connection in, and suddenly there's a lot of people to talk to or listen to, and that made the repeater sound like it was really busy. I imagine the same thing on ATV, that if you got three or four local guys, you're going to get tired of talking to each other after, or looking at each other after.
I don't want to look at your ugly face anymore.
Mm-hmm. One of the things we're doing in Amateur TV Network is, although we prefer the microwave links, but if we want to tie into the Columbus repeater, or other areas that it just wouldn't be feasible to run a microwave network coast to coast. Not less. Bill Gates made a big donation.
Yeah, but put in a satellite.
So we're starting to use IP video, although there is some latency of a couple of seconds. We're able to get full resolution picture if you have a decent internet connection, and we're working on automation so that you don't need to push any buttons. It'll automatically tie two repeaters together.
Yeah. Anybody use Skype or anything like that?
On our nets, we have somebody can Skype in if they're out of the area if they want full resolution on the repeater.
Okay. Are you connected?
No, I'm not connected, but I have done some streaming with it. It's possible to do that with VLC. The transmitter that HiDes makes, a modulator, is capable of streaming in and out of it, so it's possible to do it.
Okay, so you've streamed your picture from the repeater out on an ad hoc basis.
Right.
But you're not one of those BATV capable.
No,
not yet. We go there, we don't see you.
Yeah, I just got started in this. You know, we just built this repeater, so. Yeah.
Well, I remember, at the last DCC, you were talking about you were working on it. It wasn't on the air yet, so now it's on the air. How many people are using it?
Half a dozen of us. Yeah, not many.
Get on every night?
There's somebody around.
Find somebody.
Right.
So now let's take a couple minutes to transition to something more technical. And this is where I don't have a question, because I've got no basis or background to ask a question. But I'd ask you to start kind of general. And we stayed fairly general, although, you know, we as typical of most talk shows, we skipped around a lot. But what is there that goes well beyond typical amateur knowledge? You're saying two total novices in digital or in amateur television put on a successful repeater system.
Just connecting
point to
between
point.
Right.
Point to point. Mm-hmm.
So where does it get hard? What are the secrets? What gets revealed in the pages of ATV Quarterly?
Well, there's a lot of folks who have done ATV for a while that are very technical, and we have, in the magazine, we have not only good technical articles, but we also have operating news, and we have some simple, because some of our subscribers say, can you put a simple circuit in there? And we've had microphone preamplifiers to, or AGC-controlled amplifiers to control your audio levels, simple things that somebody can start with, and yet we've also had equipment that is much more complicated to build for those who want more of a challenge. So we have a little of everything in there.
All right. So, this is the place to start if you want to.
Correct.
I'm looking at the picture on the cover, Hack RF1. You do television through the Hack RFs?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We found, originally started last year at Dayton, we met him.
Had he thought much video?
We're
talking about Michael Osman.
We've talked to him a little bit about it. Originally, we thought this would make a great spectrum analyzer to use so that to aid in adjusting the beam for the best signal and least amount of multipath or interference. And so we were going to do a review in the magazine about that. And when we got it, we opened up, and it uses building blocks. Oh, there's a DVB-T demodulator block for it?
So it's a full receiver.
And so we're running a multi-part series. To get the simple stuff, the spectrum analyzer we did in the winter issue, how to build a basic FM radio receiver is in this issue so that people can get used to this. And we're going to do an ATV transmitter on the third, and the fourth, I think, will be the ATV receiver. And it'll do DVB-S. DVB-T's been done on this. This has a modulator and demodulator for the American 8 VSB system. This will do just about any digital format. And we just found out yesterday he has a daughter board that'll do full duplex with a high stability TCXO that'll be out shortly as a companion for this.
Wow.
And basically digital ATV, whether you're using the HiDes equipment, it's all basically more built around the software-defined radio, with all the RF components around it.
Whereas, so these are software-defined?
Right. I mean, there's some dedication in the chipsets, but other parts is totally configurable. So in general, even on HF, a lot of the new rigs that are out are essentially software-defined radios with RF around. It's just how many knobs you want to put on the radio versus how many do you want to play with the keyboard.
Yeah.
On
your Flex, which you're very familiar with, calls their RF part, you know, an RF server.
Exactly.
And then, you know, it's all software after that or before that, before and after that.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the more technical things is to learn what DVB-T is and how it works. Remember, I talked
about
that.
How the signal's put together.
Yeah, how the signal's put together, how the forward error correction, and because all those parameters are configurable, the transmission parameters. Now, obviously, if you don't have them right, you know, it's not going to work. If you've got more bits coming in, say, from your camera than you've got going out, obviously, it's not going to work. So
are there default settings when you're just getting started?
No.
I mean, how do these guys that put their, these novices that put their signal together?
Well, we have a recommended settings for the user, so they don't have to, so don't let all the individual settings scare you, because we do have a sheet of to operate the system. This works best to get on the air. Just set them this way and use them. For those who want to do more experimenting once they got used to doing digital video a little bit, then they can start playing with the settings and see what will work better for high definition, what settings work better for standard definition. If you have radar interference on 70 centimeters, what settings minimize the disruption of the picture.
So changes like that have to be done at both the transmitter and receiver end?
No.
Is there some point where your picture disappears because you became incompatible?
In general, at least with the high-des equipment, you just need to set frequency and bandwidth. The receiver will track whether you're running H.264 or MPEG-2. If you're running at QPSK, CLAM-16 or 64, the receiver we'll look at the PID information, which is it says this is how this is how the transmitter signal is configured, and then the receiver will set itself up and lock onto it.
Okay, linearity and bandwidth of antennas and stuff, those are considerations, aren't they? Amplifier linearity.
Yeah, very much.
Unless you've been in ATV, you're not used to the idea of keeping things working across 2 to 6 megahertz worth of RF.
Well, go ahead.
Otherwise, you have that flat top signal, and it comes down. If it comes down to this, what they call a skirts fly out on it, that's IMD. So your bandwidth's much wider than what it should be. So to avoid that, it's important to have good linear amplifiers, preferably a Class A amplifier, to avoid that.
All right, and
with plenty of headroom too, because there's a lot of peak power.
Your off-the-shelf amplifiers are all designed for that, but.
No.
The ones from HTV Video are, there's also some broadcast palette amplifiers that work well. Mm-hmm. But in general, we usually use Class A up to anywhere from about a watt to maybe as much as 10 watts. And in the larger amplifiers, Class AB1 is fine. In fact, that's what we do in broadcast. Not everything, all the low-level stuff is A, and then when you get into the bigger watts, we switch to AB1 to keep the heat down.
Okay, so.
And there are amplifiers built specifically for this equipment.
Yeah, an amplifier that a sideband operator might use is not going to be.
Well, most of the quote ham amplifiers, I don't know if you want me to use names or not.
Sure.
But for example, like the Mirage D1010 was a very popular amplifier used for both FM sideband and AMTV, although there was a lot of compression because the transistors were designed for Class C operation in land mobile. They did bias them up to try to somewhat linearize them, but they're really not, the devices were never designed for linear operation. For those who are familiar with a company called RF Parts that make modules for Mitsubishi and Toshiba that are the what they call LDMOS power bricks, it's a type of FET device. They're much more linear than the bipolar bricks. And as long as you keep the power level down so you're not anywhere near saturation, they will work quite well. The broadcast palettes are even more linear, which are usually 30-volt or 50-volt devices.
Okay, so it's not that hard to make an amplifier work.
And if you want to buy one that's high power, SSB Electronics over here has the Beko line of amplifiers that are from Europe. Jim Clensing, W6PQL, has a line of amplifier kits and completed that you can buy using the LDMOS chips, including one that's a full kilowatt. So if you really want to run maximum legal power, it's there if you want it.
Yeah. I think most amateurs, though, for their home station, run about 10 watts, and that amplifier is readily available. That's what I use. You can build one, too, from the Mitsubishi block. I mean, that's biased to Class A, and it worked fine.
So you talked about the digital settings, but you've also got to be careful. Well, at least when you were talking about doing things like FreeDV and FDMDV, you were talking about being very careful not to run compression, not to run speech processing, not to overdrive your transmitter, which would be easy to do because you're not seeing much on the meter go by in those modes. You need to stay in the very linear range of everything.
Yeah, Is it the same deal? Same applies, yeah.
But in the case of the digital modulators, there is no... You're not adjusting... All of the parameters of the transmitter RF-wise... Yeah. is already set. So just all you have to worry about is once you take that low-level signal and amplify it, keep it linear. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah, it's possible to, of course, overdrive your amplifier, you know, from this. This has capability of doing that. But there's an electronic attenuator built in this, so you can set the power output this for the most linear operation of your amplifier.
And how do you see what you're doing? Go on the air and have somebody tell you.
I use a spectrum analyzer, but yes. Yeah,
everybody's got one of those.
Well, in general, because like I mentioned with the amplifiers that HTV Video has, he's already done that work for you. So you just run it. He has a three-level power switch, and then he usually recommends using the minus 15 setting on your exciter, and then it's going to fall in line. And usually most areas where you have a few ATVers, one person may have the test equipment. So if you want to try to push the limit, take your rig over to this house, set it up, and look at it. The other nice thing, both with the using the HAC RF as a spectrum analyzer, you can plug that into a receive antenna, help your friend that has no spectrum analyzer, or if you own a spectrum analyzer, hook it to your antenna, have them transmit to you, turn the power up. Oh, yeah, you got too much spectrum regrowth, turn the power down a little bit, okay, right there, and you don't have to necessarily drive over. And that's one of the beauties about amateur TV. You can, you know, do all that kind of stuff.
You've got a forum coming up, haven't you? What time is it?
12:15.
Yeah, got 5 minutes.
Oh, I guess we better send you guys off to your forum.
Yeah.
I was going to ask about ATSC3, but we'll have to do that on Skype sometime.
Okay.
Correct.
I'm curious what's coming down the pipe for us.
It's similar to DVB-T, but slightly different.
They
always got to do it a little different.
For the consumers, it's going to be, I think,
But they're going to get all the advantages of running, it uses the OFDM modulation of the carrier, just like DVB-T does. So all the advantages Europe has, and we have DVB-T, the new American system, will do that. And is capable of 4K resolution.
All right. Tell people where they can find you if they're looking for more contact on this stuff.
You can email me at whiskey alpha 6 sierra victor tango at aol.com, or you can reach me through Amateur TV Quarterly.
Google it, you'll find it.
Right.
And Mel, tell people what you're doing lately.
Well, right now this digital video is big. Yeah, getting this repeater up and running and working well. Yeah, that's what I'm doing now.
All right.
Still working in free DV. You know, I got a forum today. So, there's still a lot going on with free DV. A lot of new boats.
All right. Cool. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go if you enjoy the programs. You get something out of them. Feed Starvin, Arvin. I'll take him back from the Hamfest and put him back on the shelf. See you guys. 73. Thanks, Mike. Thank you.
Thank you for having me, Gary.
Yeah. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, over and out. So, was that fun?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Gary.
Thank you. So long. Shake hands.
Thanks, Gary.
Thank you, Mel. I think we're going to hear a thunderclap.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure you guys heard that one.